Are you ready? What's going on?
Yeah, this is just a real quick tag at the top, as we like to call it. And we're here to remind you to check out our home, where our good friends live and die, and everything in between, at allthingscomedy.com. It is a great place to really get everything you need in the world of comedy, hence the name, All Things Comedy. There are great podcasts. If you haven't checked out The Champs with Moshe Kasher and Neil Brennan and DJ Doug Pound, I know they had Chris Rock on last week. I haven't listened to that.
I'm definitely
going to download that. I'm a huge Chris Rock fan.
I've heard of Chris Rock.
Our friend Tom Rhodes has a podcast you can find there. There's also The Naughty Show and The Harlan Highway. A lot of great podcasts, so make sure you check them out. Also, it keeps you up on news. And, you know, you can, it's home base, right?
Right.
Headquarters.
For all things comedy.
So be sure to check that out. And we also want to plug our good friend.
Yes. You may remember him. Ian Bagg he's been on the show twice.
Yes.
Now. Good friend of ours.
Good friend of ours. Extremely funny human being. One of the best comedians I've ever had the pleasure of working with and watching. It really is an incredible talent. And I'm telling you, if you've never seen this guy, he is out of this world talented. And he has...
Yeah, he has a Showtime special premiering this Saturday at 11 p.m. Eastern Time. So what is the date this Saturday, Jeans? If we look it up, just so we get this right for people, today is the 2nd.
All right, good call.
Good thinking. Anyways.
The 6th.
The Saturday, April 6th, 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It is called Ian Bagg Getting to Fucking Know You.
Oh, man.
Isn't that perfect for Ian?
It's absolutely fantastic. It is... It's well worth setting the record on the DVR for. So,
because I will say that Ian is one of those comics who he does like clubs around the world.
Yeah.
He's one of those guys that is like the funniest club act. And if you don't know about him yet, check him out because he's so fucking funny.
It's out of control. You've never seen anything like it. I know it sounds crazy.
Yeah.
But that's how.
Trust us.
Set your DVR. For Ian's special on Showtime this Saturday. It's called Getting to Fucking Know You. And what time does it air? 11 p.m.
Eastern
on Showtime.
Eastern Standard Time on Showtime.
All right. That's all.
That's all.
Enjoy the show. Love you. Bye.
Meow. I like this music you find every week.
You do?
Is this from your personal back catalog?
This is basically how I used to get down.
You're so loud. Your voice is too loud in my headphones. But my voice is good enough.
But my voice is too loud?
It's way loud, yeah.
Okay.
I'm going
deaf.
How about
that? Is that better?
No, it's still loud.
How about now?
Talk more?
I'm just talking at my regular speaking voice.
Yeah, that'll be all right.
All right. I don't hear you.
You don't hear me?
I do. I hear you.
I hope so.
I hear you, dog.
I hear your dog jeans. They're so tight.
Tell us what's up.
Oh, are we recording now?
Yeah.
Hi, mommies. I'm going to be at the Denver Improv April 11th through 14th. Come see me. Or April 17th through 20th, Crackers Comedy Club in Indianapolis, downtown, that is. And then I'll be at the Moon Tower Festival in Austin, Texas, April 24th through 27th.
That's some real G shit right there.
That's as far as I'm going to go, right?
Yeah, that's some real G shit, man.
May, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Some G shit. I'm excited. Austin's cool. I really like Austin.
Austin's a great town. I'm going back.
Okay. Oh, when are you going?
I'm going to put this on my dates. So check it out. This week, I will be in Cincinnati, my hometown. Go Bananas. Please come check me out. If you're in the Nasty Natty, I will be there. Then April 11th through 13th, Vancouver at the Comedy Mix. Great club. Then a big surprise new announcement. We're doing A fundraiser for little Theo Huxtable, April 16th, which is also my birthday.
Get out. Happy birthday.
So it's going to be a birthday party slash show slash fundraiser for Theo, and it's at Flappers in Burbank, and we have the link up for tickets. Everything goes to the Theo Fund. Here's the lineup. It's pretty ridiculous. Christina and I, of course, Ari Shafir, Joseph Mad Flavor Diaz,
okay,
Bert the Machine Kreischer,
Marilyn Rice Cub,
Brian Hainer, the guitar guy.
Yeah.
Am I forgetting somebody? I feel like that's a lot of show.
I think that's all the show you'll ever need.
Yeah, it's going to be fucking bananas. So if you can, if you may, please come celebrate with us. We'll have a good time.
And celebrating the life of Mr. Theo Huxtable, who made it and who's here at our feet today with us. And thank you guys for your continued sponsorship of this dog. We're almost there.
It's pretty awesome.
One last push, hopefully.
This is it. So, but that's a cool way to do it. And, you know, if you're there, you're going to be there for a special night. So please come out to that show. Back to some other dates that I have coming up. The 18th through 21st, San Jose. The Improv there. Then the 24th through 28th, Orlando, the Improv there. Then I'm really excited about going to Toronto, May 2nd through the 4th. I'm doing the Underground Comedy Club in Toronto. And right after that, I'm going to Austin, to Cap City on May 8th.
Okay.
That was just added a little while ago. And then, of course, we go to Portland and Seattle, and we hope you guys will come and see us there if you're in the area.
What are the dates for Portland and Seattle?
May 17th and May 18th. You can get tickets at yourmomshousepodcast.com. You can also get them at tomsegura.com. There's links there. Please get your tickets.
And,
Portland,
and
don't sleep.
ChristinaComedy.com. Let's not be selfish, Tom.
Oh.
It's not always about you and your website. Oh, me. God.
Well, at Tom Segura.
Oh,
at Tom Segura. Follow
so
me at Tommy Segura, at Tom Segura.
What about my Twitter handle?
I will play
at Christina.
Yay! Here is Christina's Twitter handle.
Is that a phonetically spelled one? You follow her there. So, you know, just because you control the soundboard,
it's
kind of unfair.
Totally unfair. No, but to be fair, Christina's Twitter handle.
All you need to do is do this.
That's Christina's Twitter handle.
Thanks, Tom.
It's at Christina
P. God.
And Christina is spelled K.
I hate you.
What is it?
Stop. Communist? It's a C-H.
Oh, yeah. I just figured this out. It's C-H-R-I-S-T-I-N-A, the letter P, as in I have to pee everywhere.
And your Twitter handle is at P-O-O-P. That's poop.
That's
F-A-C-E.
Not cool.
Face.
That's not cool.
Poop face.
Diabetes.
It's not cool. All right.
Grow up, Tom.
Let's grow up. I'm so excited about this show.
We got a lot of shit to catch up on.
We got a lot of shit to catch up
We've
on.
Been in a fog the last month. I feel like we're finally coming out.
We are.
Of this, and it's back to life.
There's a lot of stuff to go over. Okay. This episode of Your Mom's House is brought to you by Stamps.com. Now, postage meter companies used to have the monopoly on printing postage. They could charge you an arm and a leg to print postage from your own office. But those days are over.
Mm.
Now you can use Stamps.com instead. With Stamps.com, get all the benefits of a postage meter, but at a fraction of the cost. All you need is your computer, printer, and Stamps.com to get official U.S. postage for any letter or package, any class of mail. Plus, you'll never have to step foot inside a crowded post office again. Everything you would do at the post office, you can do right from your desk. Super convenient. We use Stamps.com. And wait till you see the next bundle that's going out, thanks to our awesome listeners who are supporting our little FIFO Huxtable. And we're printing out a bunch of Stamps.com postage for all those orders, and we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. And right now, here's a special offer. Use our promo code MOM, that's M-O-M, for this special offer. It's a no-risk trial, $110 bonus offer. It includes a digital scale and up to $55 in free postage. Don't wait. Go to stamps.com. Before you do anything else, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage and type in mom at stamps.com and enter M-O-M. Thank you, stamps.com.
That was a good read.
You like that?
Yeah.
Thanks, babe.
I thought that was really professional.
So I try to be professional when I read.
You know, when you're Puerto Rican, you're just Puerto Rican.
I'm professional.
I think it's professional considering your Twitter handle is at poop face. I think that's pretty special.
All right, man. Are you ready to start the show?
Yeah.
You ready to do this or what?
Born ready.
Ooh, snap.
Try to slash Mainus open. Consistently testing that midsection of Mainus. Mainus getting beaten on.
What's the back of the head?
Could be in trouble here, Mainus. But Mainus is relaxed here, Pat. Still riding the back of Mainus. Good defense here from Mainus. Mainus flattened out. Mainus flat on the canvas. We are ready to rock and roll. Second round of action. There is a cut on Mainus. Mainus is ready to pounce here. The ref shoots in early. Mainus defends it. Mainus is in a bit of pain here.
You watch one, I'll watch the other, Michael.
I'll watch Mainus. Mainus taking a thumb scathe, and the ringside physician has just popped in there to look at Mainus. Mainus trying to work the clinch. You hear the referee saying, stay busy, Danny. Stop the arm in his anus. Mainus could be in trouble. Mainus just stuck here. And he pops the head out. Mainus all bloodied up here.
Well, Mainus is bleeding all over Chavez's chest.
Mainus just bleeding all over Chavez. And Quantum Crew go to work on me. Cut on Mainus.
Who is Randy?
Don't bring anyone mother to this.
Your mom in the fuck is dead.
Welcome. Welcome to your mom's house. With Tom Segura. Tom Segura. And
Christina Pajitsky.
Welcome to your mom's house.
How great is that?
You know what I think I heard?
What?
Alvider's Mainus. And I think I heard Mainus bleeding over Chavez. Over Chavez?
Chavez, the other fighter.
The Jewish holiday. Oh, Chavez, I thought.
Oh, yeah. Mainus bleeding all over Chavez. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow, how much fun was that show?
That is so fucking great. Now, for those of you that don't know, we know we have a good bit of listeners, followers who follow MMA as well. That was the voice, Michael Schiavello, calling a fight about a week and a half ago in Denver. And one of the fighters has the unfortunate reality of having the last name Mainus.
Unfortunate. I would say that's a blessing in disguise. That's called a gift.
It is quite the gift, isn't it? So Danny Mainus. But the best part is that with his Aussie accent, it's the M-A-I instead of Mainus sounds like my. So it's Mainus, Mainus, Mainus. And Schiavello, this thing has taken off. I don't know if you know. I didn't really know, but it has really exploded all over his
Mainus.
Like his Mainus. And
Mainus is relaxed yet.
So what I did today when I first saw this, I saw it yesterday, I was like, man, this is hilarious. I didn't know exactly to what degree it had exploded, but I know Michael Schiavello from Australia. The first time I went there with Rogan. Then I went back for the Melbourne International Comedy Festival, and I saw him again, him and his now wife.
Right.
Lovely, lovely people, sweet couple. So I called him, and I talked to him about what has happened in the last week since this video went viral.
He's the ain't nobody got time for that girl right
ain't
now.
Ain't nobody got time for that. He's kabooya, kabooya.
Yeah, this is his week.
It's pretty awesome. So here's my call with Mike earlier.
Hello.
Hey, Mike.
Yes.
Hey, it's Tom Segura.
Hey, Tom, how are you, mate?
Oh, fantastic. How are you, man?
Good, man. Good. How you been?
I've been great, man. I've been great. I got to tell you, man, I was not expecting to see this video of you saying Mainus, and I laughed so fucking hard at that. It absolutely made my day, and especially that
dude, it's been the funniest thing over the last week, man. I can't believe how nuts it went.
Dude, it's to the point where the video, I mean, you know, especially the outtakes, I felt like it was a sketch. I'm like, did they do this on purpose? Tell me about your past week, please.
Well, we did the live show from Denver, Colorado, and, you know, it was live on Access TV. And then what happened was Saturday night, I got home from Denver, and a fan had uploaded a video on YouTube of these clips of his favorite parts of the fight, of the commentary. And it popped up my Google alert, so I had a look at it, and my wife and I got a bit of a laugh out of it. And then we wake up the next morning, and the thing's got like 100,000 views. And then, you know, the next day it's got like 200,000 views. And then that night it pops up on the late night show with Jimmy Fallon, and Jimmy Fallon's on there making gags about it and laughing about it, and his audience is laughing about it. And as the days went on, it's like 300,000 views, 400,000 views. I just kept going up, 500,000 views. Then I started to get these radio requests from radio stations in Miami and Houston, in Ontario, Canada, in San Francisco, in Iowa. Interview with the biggest radio station back home in Australia. The newspaper articles, you know, the New York Post put something on their website. The Daily Mirror in the UK put something on their website. It's been a nutty week. It's the most attention my commentary's ever had, which is saying something because, you know, Tom, I've commentated the Commonwealth Games, the Olympic Games, you know, all the big sporting events around the world. I've covered two World Cups of soccer, but it's for the pronunciation of Danny Mainus that makes me virally famous on the internet.
You stop and think about that for a second. You know, like when you really consider what Michael has covered, it's really substantial. I mean, it's significant. World Cups, Olympics, and by far, him saying Mainus is getting notoriety
so
around
much heat
the world.
It's because
so
it's a seventh grade joke that Americans love.
Right. Well,
it's
the world. So I mean, funny. Everybody loves something like that, right?
Oh,
I mean,
it's so just great.
This is something that I could play forever.
Of all things.
Ah, man, that is fantastic. And now, hey, to top it off. Off all those shows, now you're on your mom's house podcast. I mean, what's bigger than that?
Dude, this being on here, when you contact me, I'm like, what? Tom Segura's podcast? Are you serious? You and I go way back. For fans who don't know, you and I go way back to your days of traveling with Joe Rogan down under in Australia.
Down under.
And it's good to be on here with you.
Brother.
The funny thing about that video, bro, I'm going to tell you is that that fight was not just unique because of Danny Mainus's name sounding like my anus, but also because Tom, and you know, you're a mixed martial arts fan, so you'll get this. Everything that could have happened in a mixed martial arts fight had to happen in that very fight. I mean, there was stuff in that fight that I've never commentated before. For example, both guys thumb each other in the eye at the same time. I've never seen that before. So, of course, Mainus takes a thumb. And then Zach Chavez begins punching Mainus with two fists at a time, double fists. So, of course, Mainus gets double fisted. I mean, you never see. It just had to happen all in this one fight. It was crazy.
It was crazy. And then there were so many. I mean, just when you think there's not another place to go for Mainus commentary from you, especially with your accent, it goes then to Mainus is bleeding and Mainus is relaxed. And it just keeps going and going. I mean, you actually, like, if I was writing jokes and they were like, just how many ways, like, what jokes could you write about Mainus? I would have fallen short of what you had naturally. You know what I mean? Like, I couldn't have come up with all the stuff you said.
Man, the thing was that we met Danny the day before because we interviewed all the fighters the day before to talk about their strategies and their camp, and the name just didn't jump out at me. Then about 10 minutes before we went live on air, I turned to my co-commentator, Pat Miletic, former UFC middleweight champion, and I said to him, Pat, how do you pronounce this name? And I pointed out, and he goes, Mainus. I go, okay. And then I turned to our CEO, of the network. I thought, okay, the head honcho, let me see how he pronounces it. I go to him, mate, boss, how do you pronounce this name? And he's like, Mainus, like his anus. I'm like, all right, I'm just checking it out. And then right before we go on air, Pat nudges me and he goes, hey, Michael, can you imagine if Mainus gets cut? That's going to be hilarious. And I'm like, Pat, I know it's a funny name, but I'm just going to play the commentary as straight as I possibly can.
Definitely.
So the fight starts and, you know, Mainus is walking out to the cage. And Pat starts laughing straight away. He's laughing. He's got his finger on the cough button. He's twirling around in his chair. So deliberately for the whole fight, Tom, I turn my back to Pat so I can't look at him.
Of course.
So I don't get the giggles. but the bad thing was that A, I can hear him vibrating and gyrating behind me in laughter. B, I've turned my back to him, and in front of me is our makeup artist, our stage manager, our floor manager, and our sound director. And they're all writhing about laughing, so I couldn't look there. I turn another direction, and the CEO of the network has ripped off his earphones because he's rolling around laughing. It's like everyone looks, everyone's just picking themselves laughing.
This is the best, man. This is absolutely fit. So everybody was losing their shit, and rightfully so, and couldn't keep it together while you were doing your... And one of the first things I think that happened in that fight is that he said, can you imagine if Mainus gets cut? And he did get cut pretty early on, right?
He got cut early on. Hence, he was like bleeding everywhere by the second round, which again, as we said, opens itself up to so many things.
Yeah.
And again, if people have heard me commentate before in the past, you'll know that I'm pretty graphic when I describe fights. If it had been a guy with the surname Smith, I would have commentated the exact same way.
Of course.
It just so happened that the guy's name is Mainus, and Mainus is bleeding, Mainus is cut, and Mainus is blood everywhere, and Mainus is getting stunned, Mainus is getting double fisted, Mainus is relaxed, Mainus is in trouble, Mainus is in the clinch. It just kept going.
I'm going to be playing those sound drops on our show for a year.
You're not the only one. I tell you what, it's been a funny reaction all week, man, to hear the way that the ESPN radio in Denver did it as their WTF moment of the week, and it was hilarious to listen to. And I still listen to the video now, and I watch it, you know, on YouTube, just have a look how many views it's up to, and I still sit there and giggle to myself. I think it's just one of those timeless things that, like you said earlier, I think you hit the nail on the head, is that if it had been a comedy sketch or if I had made a joke about it during the broadcast, I don't think it would have been as funny as the way it was me just playing it straight and trying to commentate it straight, because I think half the humor is in that. People are watching and thinking, oh my God, this Aussie commentator is actually commentating this thing straight and not making a joke out of it. And with my accent, apparently it makes it even funnier.
You're 100% right. The fact that you were 100% professional broadcaster and you just were saying it as it were, like you said, if it had been Smith, you'd have commented it the same way. And that's what's so hilarious about it, is that it's spot on. You're not trying to say it in a jokey way, and that's why it's so damn hilarious. It's so funny.
And the thing is, I'm really glad that Danny himself took it well. You know, after it came out and it went viral, I thought to myself, and I rang Pat and I said, Pat, geez, I hope Danny Mainus doesn't take this the wrong way, but I can't help it. The dude's got an unfortunate name. That's the name he's born with. You know, it's like, whatever, man, you can't change it. But then he started tweeting about it a few days ago, and he was tweeting the link to the Jimmy Fallon show and tweeting all the links to the newspapers and the websites and the radio interviews. And, you know, it's probably the best thing to happen to this kid's career. He's like a one-on-one fighter. He's had two fights. No one knew who the hell he was. He was the first fighter on the card, you know. And now, though, Tom, after a week, he's probably the most well-known MMA fighter in the world over the last week. And if he's got good management, he can capitalize on it, because what network is not going to want to put Danny Mainus on the air again just to get more gold nuggets out of him?
Oh, dude, 100%. And if this guy does not have the sense to make a shirt that says Mainus is bleeding, then he doesn't know what's good for him, okay?
He doesn't know marketing at all. If I don't see that in his next fight, if he is not walking out to the ring with a shirt that says Mainus is bleeding and on the back it says Mainus is cut or Mainus is relaxed, then he doesn't know marketing. You know, I was thinking back, and you know how I said that everything that could happen did happen in that fight?
Yeah.
If you watch that video again that fan put on there, this is another funny thing. Usually, as you know, going to so many UFC fights yourself, when it comes to the end of a round, they use like a clapper or they use a bell. Well, it just so happened that in these fights, they used an air horn to signal the end of the round. So mind you, here I am saying Mainus over and over again, but at the end of the round they blow an air horn that sounds like a giant fart. I mean, just every you turned with this fight, there was one thing after the other.
That's fantastic, dude. It's so much fun. It's so much fun to watch fights, but to have this extra level of it is so great. And to the people that don't know Michael, you're the best, dude. Such a great guy. I'll never forget, ever forget, meeting you the first time, nor the next time when I went to Melbourne and you and Irene were so gracious and took me out and showed me such a good time, took me around. I'm so happy for all your success, man. And I'm I'm thrilled to know that you live in the States now a year later. So the next time I'm in Vegas, if you're not traveling somewhere else, hopefully we can get together then too, man.
Brother, I would absolutely love to, man. It's been an absolute pleasure. It's been far too long since I've seen you. You're one of the funniest motherfuckers I know, and I love it. And your stand-up, I hope I can see another one, man, because last time when you were performing at the Melbourne International Comedy Festival, you were one of the true highlights. It was awesome, brother. So next time you're in Vegas, let me know, and thank you for having me on the show, man. It's a little dream come true for me to be on Tom Segura's podcast, which is super cool.
Thanks, brother. You're the best. Please send my love to Irene, and I'll talk to you soon, man.
Will do. Thanks, Tom. See you, bro.
See you, buddy. So there you have it.
Wow.
The voice, Mike Schiavello.
That was a Your Mom's House exclusive.
Pretty cool, right? I mean, what a great guy. How can you not? You're in love with the guy immediately, right? He's just such a fun guy. If you want
to
hit him up on Twitter, his Twitter handle is Schiavello Voice. It's spelled Schiavello Voice. The voice, Michael Schiavello, joining us on Your Mom's House to talk about, well, you know.
There is a cunt on Mainus.
It's like that
so
was
much fun.
Just for our show.
It really is. Yeah. And that's very, you're right, it is very juvenile, right?
It's so great. And on the other hand, though, I mean, we all got called stuff growing up, like because of my last name, Pashitsky was huge. And even to this day, when people are like, oh, Pashitsky.
How do I say your
still
name?
Yeah. Pashitsky. But can you believe his whole life, that guy was called Anus, and
Mainus,
then
yeah.
Now it's come.
It's a whole different level, yeah. At least he can have fun with it, and like Mike pointed out, if he's smart, he can make some money off of it, you know? I mean, some of these things are just...
But Mainus is relaxed here, Pat.
I mean, Mainus is relaxed is might be my shirt.
Oh, it's so, you know? Great, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, he should have a cape that he comes out. Do they come out in capes, those fighters?
No.
Like the old school wrestlers?
No, these aren't like WWF guys.
What do they do for showmanship? Is there
There's a lot of showmanship. I mean, they always come out to a song, and okay. They come out with an entourage.
How about fireworks? So they're explosions?
You don't see a lot of fireworks with them. The craziest intro I saw to a fight wasn't an MMA fight recently. It was, I played it for you. I didn't play it for you. I played part of it. It was... I mean, let's see. Oh, this guy, Adrian Broner.
Connected a lot against DeMarco, I think, which is one of the reasons you're as hot as you are right now. What do you feel about this, which is, after all, the follow-up performance to that masterpiece?
You know, same shit, different toilet.
Adrian
right,
Broner.
Right, I remember that.
He went to the ring and he sang. Here's Adrian Broner. He rapped a song with a rapper. And a headphone on the way to a fight. Usually fighters are pretty focused and, like, you know,
in the zone because they're about
in the
to get
zone.
The shit kicked
and then something
out of
them. Hyped up is one thing, but to actually, I'm going to perform on the way to the ring, that's pretty crazy.
The disease that has impacted the lives of so many.
It's too late there. But yeah, Adrian Broner was, and that he's a boxer though. He's not an MMA guy. And he also, there was a video of him that came out, the same guy last week. He was in Miami. And he was in the hotel balcony with his boys, and he had just a stack of $10,000 in hundreds, and he was like counting them out, throwing them on the balcony, like, oh, I got all this. And then there were some 20s in there. He's like, ah, man, someone slipped some 20s into my shit. I don't fuck with change or nothing. Like, I don't like if he buys something for $3. Well, no, if it's $3, he pays with 100.
Right.
And then you keep the change because he doesn't fuck with change. But,
wow.
But anyway, so he took the 20s and he tore them up and flushed them down the toilet on the video.
Wow.
Pretty brazen, pretty gross.
Yeah. That's gross.
There's no need to do something like that. But yeah, he's pretty much the most ridiculous intro I've seen to the ring in a while.
Wow. But yeah. MMA, you're telling me they don't carry the same flair?
No, they do have flair, but it's more like, you know certain personalities. I feel like most of those guys are pretty, you know, they're focused. They each have like their, like some of them will play like, you know, like, you know, Mexican campesino kind of music.
What's that?
You know,
campesino.
Like, you know,
burr, 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 like our filler up.
Like filler up kind of, yeah. Like Cain Velasquez might be like, walk to the ring, some shit like this. And guys come out to hip hop or they'll be like a country boy. He'll come out to some country shit. But it's basically pretty standard as a walk. They just walk to the ring. Mm. And then some of them are, you know, more head to the ground, just kind of zoned out. Some of them are a little more like, you know, showy, you know, maybe more high fives, throw a shout to the crowd kind of shit, high five people on the way to the ring. Right. It's pretty standard, though.
It sounds to me it's a little more dignified because these dudes really...
This is a real fight.
They fuck each other up so hard that they're like, I ain't got time. Anybody got time for that?
Ain't nobody got time for that
To clown. They're not clowning as hard as, say, boxers. It's not so much of a bullshit thing because that shit is real, okay? That is real.
Absolutely. And, they don't fuck around. I mean, of course, I'm probably missing out on somebody and somebody will let us know. What about fucking...
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
You know, Tony Marchez. I don't fucking know, man. I don't know everybody's...
What about your mom?
Yeah.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know. But for the short answer is, yeah, you don't see a lot of that shit.
That's exciting. I once went to a WWE event with an ex-boyfriend of mine. Oh, I don't know if you've ever been to one.
No.
I went primarily for the hot dogs and for the beer and for the crowd because it's a real serious crowd.
Yeah.
And I'm just picking my nose. It's not that big of a deal. They really put the showmanship into the intros and like the storylines behind it.
Yeah. I have zero interest in that shit.
The Undertaker!
And then like the lightning flashes and then like all the Mexican dudes are like, yeah, fucking Undertaker!
I have friends that are so into this, like good friends of mine, and I just have zero interest in that shit. 0.0.
In wrestling? Because it's fake.
It's just stupid to me.
It's fake. It's fake.
Well, of course it's fake, but that's
Wait a minute. It's fake?
It's so fake.
I know, huh?
It's so stupid. It's fucking dumb, man.
I know, like, dude.
These god awful, and then like they're all everything looks the same. He's like, you disrespected me. I'm gonna come get you.
Yes.
And it's some stupid fucking character, and it's a guy in tights, and he's just like, you know, I'm gonna come after you and your family.
Right. And I didn't understand why do you hate that guy?
Why
so
is
much?
Anybody over seven into this shit? And I have friends that are 35 that are like, did you see the last fucking WWE throwdown or whatever it's called? I'm like, nah, man.
Right.
I didn't. It's fucking retarded.
That beef isn't even real.
Of course not. Those guys are all best friends.
Like comedians.
Yes,
they're
exactly like that.
Be like,
Rogan, I'm coming for you, man. I'm gonna tell these jokes.
Yeah, this fucking, so weird.
I gotta get this guy on the phone. Marty DeRosa is a comedian in Chicago. He loves this shit. Loves this shit.
Yeah.
I gotta pick his brain about his fascination with this because I just I get that the guys, don't get me wrong, the guys are talented.
Yes.
They're athletic. They're athletes.
It's a skill. They're definitely athletes.
They're absolutely
an athletic
athletes.
Skill.
Yeah. I mean, these guys can do, you know, incredible shit. They have an incredible amount of steroids in them. They're very strong guys. But I don't
totally
get why.
It's so bananas.
And why people are so excited about it.
Do you remember like when we were kids, though, like Captain Lou Albano and Cyndi Lauper and Andre the Giant. And
Under
Rowdy Roddy Piper.
Yes, Rowdy Piper.
I like that. I liked all that era.
Hulk and then...
Huge star Hulk.
And Snap into a Slim Jim.
Yeah. What was that? The fire guy? What was his name? Randy Savage?
Yes.
What?
Macho Man.
Macho Man Randy Savage.
Yeah
dude.
But I was also in second or third grade.
Right, which is
and
the time
like,
that you should be into that.
And it was like a fucking like a fake superhero kind of thing, right? Or you're like, oh, these guys are awesome.
You know what?
I turned 9.
I know it's ultimate gayness. What about remember when Captain Lou Albano? He had all those rubber bands in his beards in his beard.
Yeah,
that was like his hook was the rubber bands in the beard.
Ridiculous hooks.
I remember being like, what's that hook? Like, anyone need a rubber band? I got 10 of them. So crazy.
So stupid. The I feel like the motto for that shit, that WWE shit, should absolutely 100% just be
for the dudes. That
that's what it's all about. It is just for the dudes looking for dudes. It's so fucking
maybe
stupid.
Maybe.
Oh
no, we
God.
Can't judge. You know, I like dumb
I like
shit.
Judging.
I do too, but then on the other hand, I know the dumb shit that I like. I really like Duck Dynasty. I know how fake Duck Dynasty is, yeah. And I watch that.
That's true.
Amish Mafia.
Yeah.
Totes fake.
I guess these are guys that just I don't know, it excited them from that age. Here's something that excites me. Something that you got me into.
Oh my God, are we talking about this
sure.
in public?
Then and all the wrestling fans. You can make fun of me now. I know you guys are upset because I made fun of your wrestling. Well, guess what I love more than anything on earth right now?
It's ridiculous.
It's pretty bad. I'm always, by the way, just like this before we say it. And I think I enjoy it more this way, is that I'm always a year or two behind at the height
behind,
of something's.
Behind the curb?
The kind, not just behind that curb, the side curb, but I don't get into the shows at the height of their popularity.
Right.
I'm always, and then I get the season and I watch it.
I agree.
I'm happy.
I'm the same way. I haven't even started Homeland. However, I feel like once you and I dip into that, we're going to be like, why didn't we watch Homeland?
But I cannot believe, cause, and I've expressed to you how good it is. You would just turn over and go to sleep when I put on The Wire. It's so good. It's the best show I've ever seen.
I think because I got into it second or third season deep and I didn't know all the backstory. So it was hard for me to get into the characters.
Okay, here's the
difficult.
Backstory. There's a lot of drugs and the blacks are there.
Gotcha.
Got
okay.
it?
Okay.
All right.
I'm sorry.
And
let's
the
go
cops are out to get them. Ready?
Drugs.
Drugs, drugs, guns, black yelling. Here we go. Action.
A lot of black yelling, a lot of benches, a lot of cool nicknames.
There's, oh my God.
A lot of pookies and dookies and fookies.
There's all kinds of shit going on there, man.
Hey, yo!
There you go. That's from The Wire.
Oh yeah.
That is from The Wire.
Well, are you going to tell the people what you're interested in?
All right, guys. Christina, it's Christina's fault, and I have no shame.
No shame in your game.
Masterpiece Theater proudly presents Downton Abbey.
There you go.
Lord Crawley, it's time for dinner.
But what about my dress?
Put on your tuxedo and come down for
Carson,
summer.
Carson, how come this all hasn't been poured into the marvel?
My favorite.
That shit is fantastic.
Mr. Bates, where are you, Mr. Bates?
So for those of you who don't know, this is a British series that debuted a few years ago, and then about a year later it came over to the States, and it is a smash hit. In the UK, and it, you know,
yeah, it's
the,
a BBC the, show, and it was a really big deal because they filmed it. I'm not sure what the location was, but I remember when they were filming it, it was such a huge deal because it was so expensive.
Yeah.
To have this estate and the costumes.
That's a real estate that they film it.
Of course, that's what I'm saying. That's what I fucking said, Tom. So, you know. Okay, well, so they filmed it there, and England was like, oh my God, you're filming at this historic location, and the costumes are super expensive. Like, it's not a bullshit series, right? It's not The fucking Wire, where it's a, you know.
That's a bullshit series?
I'm saying in terms of costs, like, oh, you got to put a do-rag on this guy. It's like, it's very expensive.
Oh my God.
What?
I don't think The Wire was cheap to film, just
but
just
it was
so
all
you know.
The costuming was like, oh, he's the
more
do-rag.
Okay,
all
right.
Silver teeth, whatever. But Downton Abbey was like, full old-timey English regalia, like full. What do you like best about it? What do you like best about the show? Let's talk about this.
Well, why don't we tell them what the show is first, fuckface? You haven't even told them what the show is.
I can't believe you just called me fuckface. You know what?
That was so much fun.
You know what? Ever since we became parents, I feel like our relationship has shifted.
Really?
I mean, all your love goes to Theo. What about me? What about my love? What about my kisses?
That's
I love
true.
You, Theo. Oh, FIFO.
You're right.
Oh, FIFO.
Oh, you're right. I haven't thought about that. This is a precursor to, this is what happens.
When you have kids?
Yeah, people always complain about that.
Well, why don't you sweat some more?
I'm pretty hot.
So Downton Abbey is about the old times in England. pre-World War One, right about the turn where society has changed from
right
lords,
getting into World War One,
getting into in World War One, and it's all about like this family, the Crawleys, and they're super super wealthy, and all they do is the women do needlepoint all day, mm-hmm. and it's all about changing your outfits for lunch. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They have to wear three different outfits, and it's all about the formalities of old-timey English life, and it's on two levels. You've got the butlers and the maids and their life, literally in the basement of the home, mm-hmm. and then the proper home with the lords and the ladies and who's getting married and who's yeah. the state inheritance. And
so you basically have, there's two classes of people mm-hmm. living in the same home and existing in the same home and coexisting at times.
Right.
Now, to those of you who may have heard of this show and were like, yeah, I don't really want to watch a maid butler show. I'm not really interested. Here's the thing that I've been thinking about when I was thinking about how much I love the show.
Yeah.
And it is simply this. Anything that is done exceptionally well mm-hmm. and executed exceptionally well in the arts, in any type of performance, is captivating and great to everybody.
Yes.
So that means if you go, you know, I don't really, I'm not really a fan of, I don't know, soccer. And I go, okay, I get it. But just do me a favor, watch these highlights of Lionel Messi or Cristiano Pele. Ronaldo or Pele. Just watch these highlights of them playing. There's, unless you're completely without any type of heartbeat, you're going to be captivated just by that level of skill. Mm-hmm. They're so talented that for just a moment, you're going to be like, holy shit, I've never seen anybody do that. In the arts, it's the same way. I could say, you know, hey, you want to go to this concert? I'm not really interested. Well, it's Aretha Franklin. Just watch her sing a song.
Right.
You could be completely not into that. You're going to watch her sing a song. And it's so fantastic that you're just going to go, wow,
yeah,
that's
like, it's
amazing.
So well done. Everything.
It's so well done.
From the way it's filmed.
The talent. And the talent, the writing.
Talent,
the directing, the locations, acting, the details of the clothing, yes. all of that. It's at such an exceptional level that it's, you watch an episode or two and you're hooked.
Hooked.
Yeah.
I know, because I watch this shit on the road. I think on Netflix, I streamed the first season, and then you got into it, and now we're both into it this week, Downton Abbey. And you know what I really liked about this show, too, is that it really gives perspective on, how should I say this, on serving others. If they don't see it, the servants, I think the word servant even sounds demeaning, but they really take it with a lot of pride, what they do. It's extremely important how they serve. And, you know, is Lord Crawley's suit perfectly pressed? And they take so much pride in their work that you see that everybody in that society had a function that was really, really respected. And it wasn't just about, like, people treating servants like shit.
Right.
If you had a lick of sense to you, if you were classy, truly classy.
I can't recommend it enough. I mean, how often do you get... We're in an era right now, I guess, of great television. And everybody has their tolerance. You know, I've obviously heard tons about like Sons of Anarchy and
I haven't even seen that one yet.
What's the Walking Dead?
I haven't seen that.
I watched Little Mad Men and I honestly wasn't like just. I know it's supposed to be really good, but I just didn't really get into it. So there's all these great shows. Game of Thrones is another one that premiered. The season premiere for the third season was last night. Broke all the records for season premieres for HBO. Yeah.
I started to watch an episode of that on demand, and it was so like medieval, and I just wasn't in the mood. Like, you know, when you're like, I can't watch people be dirty and cold right now.
Right.
Maybe next week I'll be into that.
Well, I think I would have felt that if I had just come across Downton. Like flipping through, I might have been like, I don't want to watch this fucking British bullshit of these servants. Like, I don't care.
Lord Crawler.
Yeah, but the fact that I sat down, you're like, I'm watching this from the, and we started watching it.
Yeah.
Totally hooked. And I also realized, like, five episodes in, I was like, oh, now I understand the fascination with soap operas.
Yeah.
Because this is essentially a really well-written soap opera with the multiple storylines, betrayal and jealousy and, you know, intrigue, affairs.
Don't
and
bother
all this.
Tommy. He's watching his stories.
It's all that. It is all that. So I am totally, completely a Downton daddy.
A Downton mommy and daddy. Mm-hmm, oh, my God. It is a good show, man. You know, those English, they are like that. When I lived in England, there's a lot of, there is still some of that formality. You don't really wear your heart on your sleeve the way Americans do. Americans are very unique in that we're straight shooters, man. We tell it like it is.
Yeah.
Eastern Europeans can be that way too, but you know, that is, it's not so, English.
You know, this is still English now. Obviously it's, more so in the era of the show, but when you, on the show, when you watch, like, and they'll be like, I won't, I guess I'll see you when I get back from London in however long, they're like, bye.
right.
Like there's no hugs.
No hugging.
No kiss.
Fuck hugging or like mouth kissing.
Yeah, no.
It's huge impropriety. I don't want to blow anything, but Lord Crawley may have placed an inappropriate kiss on somebody.
God, why are you telling them?
And Tommy and I had a moment where we turned to each other like, what? A kiss on the mouth?
Yeah. I know there's people out there being like, this is bullshit. You listen to me. Listen to me.
Mine is flattened out.
Mine is flattened out after I sat down to watch this show, and it's that fucking good. Yes. It's so good.
I might have feelings for you, Tommy, but I'll be back from the war, and maybe we can talk
about it. Well, won't she have something waiting for her when she gets back from the refugees? Perfect impression.
That was really good.
You try me, fatso.
You try me, fatso. Oh, we've been saying that one a lot. That was from our last episode.
Yeah.
With, what's his name? Tony.
With Tony Hinchcliffe. How fucking, if you missed the last episode, right now you're hearing this on a Wednesday, possibly Thursday. We had a bonus last week. Tony Hinchcliffe was here and he talked to us all about his, growing up in a mafia family. It's really like one of the most fascinating conversations we've ever had. Yeah, absolutely.
My favorite is when Tony goes, sometimes when I call my dad, I just mess with him at the end of the conversation. I go, I love you.
And he goes,
and then what does the dad say?
Yeah. And then he just, all right. Okay. And then he just hangs up. He doesn't know what to do.
That's so great.
You try me, fatso.
Try me.
Who's... I'll be down there tomorrow.
You're getting good at it. I like it.
Yeah.
Do it again. You know, fuck me. That's what you do.
Tomorrow I'm going to come down to the bank and if you don't have my money, I'm going to split your fucking head open.
Because I don't give a shit.
I don't give a fuck. I don't give a fuck about jail. I'm fucking stupid. That's my business.
You could try me, fatso.
Yeah.
God, it's so fatso.
Never mind, Sam. This is personal, he says. Sam, he's like, never mind, Sam. This is personal. I'll be down here tomorrow. You try me, fatso.
Fatso makes me laugh so hard.
Fatso, it's such a throwback.
Yes.
That's a fifth grade one, right?
That's a fifth grade insult that's really effective. That's really effective. I'm trying to think of another
good one.
It does cut deep and it's silly. It's not too mean.
Yeah.
Especially, you know what's another good comeback, fifth grade style? If someone's fucking with you, you just go, so?
Yeah.
And like, what can you say to so?
So is a good one,
yeah. You're welcome. Use that.
It's great when you have a limited vocabulary to risk. You know what I mean?
Like me?
If you want to say something, like somebody gets you, you're like, so?
So?
And it's like, I don't have to say anything else. I just said so.
I know, man. It's a perfect comeback. So,
So?
Speaking of, we figured we should give you guys an update, update.
Yeah.
The little dude's doing way better. Took a few squirrely dumps today, but I think that might be on account of us feeding him pills and hot dog meat. Maybe a little bit too much. Maybe too much on the treats because we've been spoiling him to gain weight.
Yeah, you got not only that, but you gotta hide those pills.
Yeah, they're huge.
Not eat the pills.
This dog is on a cocktail of pills.
Yeah.
He's like a fucking, I don't know. I was going to say something terrible, but I won't.
Okay, skip it. We've expressed it before, but we have to continue to express our gratitude to you, our listener, who came through really helped support this amazing little doggy by ordering extra stuff from our store and donating, and it really blew us away.
Overwhelmed. I would say that... it's been a really crazy experience adopting this dog, going through the sickness part with this dog, and now the outpouring of emails and support from you guys.
It's been crazy.
It's so beautiful, and it really kind of restores my faith in humanity, because just when you think human beings suck so bad, you guys do something really nice like that. And thank you.
You try me, fatso.
Try me, fatso.
It's pretty awesome. And yeah, we're continuing it, obviously. If you're local, if you're LA area, April 16th, it's my very special birthday. And we're
going
to do a fundraiser show to try to come up with the rest of what we need for Theo. And I hope you guys, if you're around, please come to that show. It'll be so much fun.
It's gonna be so much fun.
Like, okay, how old are you gonna be now?
I'm gonna be 34. Yeah.
It's kid stuff.
Well, how old are you gonna be?
I'm 47 years young.
You are not 47.
I'm gonna be 37 this year. Can you believe that?
Wow.
Did you believe that, dude? We've been together this long. I'm almost gonna be 40, bro.
I know, bro.
It's fucking depressing.
The thing I always take comfort in is that when you turn 40,
mm-hmm.
I will be 37, right? Is that right?
Yeah.
No, but just hear me out.
It still makes me angry that you're 3 years younger than me. I don't like it.
Right, but here's the cool part.
Yeah.
When I'm 38, you'll turn 41.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm 39,
mm-hmm.
you'll be 42. I'm still not there. I get these years to live in this other decade.
No, I get it. And every time your birthday comes up, it enrages me every single year. I'm like, oh, you're still in your fucking, you're still that young. I hate it. Because you don't even know what's up yet. You know what I mean? You're not even 35.
Minus is getting beaten on.
The other day we had a little discrepancy, you and me, about dog shit.
Well, all right. Here's what... I did get fired up that day.
You got a little fired up, dude.
Yeah. Well, here's what I was trying to tell you.
Yeah.
And I think some of our listeners will agree and some of them won't. But what I told you was that I want to get in the habit of picking up dog shit because...
You could try me, fatso.
I don't want to be, and here's the important thing here, dog shit yard people. I don't want to be a white trash piece of shit. That has just a yard of shit. And I told you this, and you were like, well, I mean, and I go, no, we are not those people. We are not going to be, this yard is just covered in shit.
So what? But here's the thing, man. Like, every house I've lived in, we've been dog shit people.
Well, we're going to change that.
But I just thought that's what Americans do.
No.
Maybe that's what Hungarians do. My dad... we always had dogs. The backyard is for the dog to shit in. That's
I agree.
Why you got a yard.
I agree.
So you
got
to pick that shit up.
No. Well, here's what you do. You don't have to pick it up at the moment.
Uh-huh.
But it's like when you go out again and you find some hard turds, you don't have to use your bare hands. You get like a little scooper or you get a bag and you just dispose of some of that so you don't become the dog shit people yard. I don't want to be that.
Well, newsflash, Tom, because we're renters.
Yeah.
You know, there's a gardener that comes and he cleans up.
I don't know if he does that.
What do you think? He's going to leave the shit there?
There's some old turds in that yard right now. There's some pretty old turds.
Not from our dog, from the cat. That cat that lives next
to... All right, but I don't know if he's really on the turd patrol.
Of course he's on the turd patrol.
All right.
Look, we got all those leaves in the front yard. You think he's going to selectively pick out the turds from the leaves?
I'll talk to him next week or this week when he's here. I'll talk to him.
Comes on Wednesday.
I'll say, what's the deal, brother? What's the deal with the turds? You take care of that?
Well, don't ask him. Why would you ask?
He speaks Spanish. I can talk to him the same way I spoke to that guy years ago in the restaurant. Me cago. Me cago en el baño. And he told me.
I remember it was the best thing ever. That was one of those moments where I was glad I married you.
How often do you have him?
Do I have to answer that right now?
Jesus.
No, remember that? This is the best story ever. So Tommy and I were eating brunch. This is years ago in Silver Lake. And you were like, oh, you say it to me. You're like, I got to take a shit.
Yeah.
And you're like, where's the bathroom? And I'm like, well, ask that guy right there. I don't know. I don't fucking work here, you know?
That's right.
And you went up to him. And the dare was, we go, why don't you tell that guy? Tell him, I got to take a shit.
Yeah.
Where's the bathroom? I dared Tommy to do it.
Yeah. So I walked up to that guy. He was a busboy, I think. He was clearing a table. And he turned around. And I was standing right over there. Oye, me cago. ¿Dónde está el baño? And he was like, over there. He just pointed. He didn't blink. He didn't say, he didn't, nothing. I told that guy, I got a shit. Where's the bathroom? Right over there, brother.
Not
no
even,
hesitation.
Not a flinch.
Not a flinch.
That's a real man.
Of course.
Do you think he gets asked that so frequently?
I think where he's from, that's definitely what a guy said. He doesn't say, pardon me.
Yes.
Do you know where the powdering room is?
The restroom. Pardon me, Lord Crowley.
Guys around him go, I got a shit, man. Where the fuck is that bathroom?
Oh, it's so great.
Yeah.
That was a good moment.
It was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Pretty
well,
amazing.
Look, I'm not offended at being a dog shit person. My dad was a dog shit person.
All right.
I don't know. I just, we had a yard and I know that that's, the yard is for the dog to shit.
What are you, listener of your mom's house? Are you a yard filled with shit person? Or are you a, hey, every once in a while, I'm going to go out there, scoop some of that up, toss it away. Who do you want to be? Who do you want to be in the neighborhood?
I'll tell you what I don't have time for.
Mm.
Picking up hard dog shit. I don't care. Leave it there. Let it. It's natural.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
It's natural. It's natural fertilizer, man. I don't give a fuck. Let him shit where he wants. He's a sick dog. This dog survived death's door. He's going to shit where the fuck he wants to shit. You know what I'm saying?
Obviously.
You know what's so funny, dude? I was just thinking that you and I have been just adoring this dog. I mean, this dog sleeps on the bed with us.
Yeah, it's crazy.
We get angry when he wants to stop cuddling and leaves us. Like,
yes.
Tom gets notably upset. Like, no, you can't leave me. I'm not done cuddling you.
Yeah, I do. It's really silly.
It's so cute. Like, we're just doting. And it was never like that in my house growing up with dogs.
Has it changed? Because I tell you what. This sounds crazy. My entire outlook has changed in the last week or two with this dog about more than just him. Like, just animals and kindness and affection in general.
Yeah, it's changed you. It's softened your heart.
Yeah, totally.
Your bear heart.
Absolutely.
I think me too.
I look at things differently, like people who post pictures of their dogs. I'm like, oh, this person loves this thing so much. I used to be like, what a fucking retard. And now I totally view it differently. I really do. I do.
That's interesting. I feel as though my heart is softened too.
Yeah.
I feel like because we're so responsible for him and he's so vulnerable, like it's so scary. I can't even imagine that feeling with a kid. When, like, that kid can really fuck up its life. And you're like, oh, my God, I love you.
He's got the neck cocked to the side. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy.
Because my dad, growing up with dogs, it was totally different.
What was it like?
First of all, we give Fifo, like, a bath in our sink. Because he's little. He's, like, 8 pounds. He can do that. My dad, we used to have a cocker spaniel.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. You're not ready for this, listener.
I didn't think it was that weird until I got a dog. And I'm like, I would never do that. So Elvis, we had a little cockapoo. My dad would be like, I'm going to give the dog a bath. I'm like, oh, okay. So let's go upstairs. He's like, no, it's okay. He turns the hose on. Freezing cold water, okay? And I'm not even saying it's the middle of summer. Like, this is an LA day, but it's not 100 degrees out.
Yeah.
Hoses the poor dog down in the backyard with just freezing cold water.
Babe, this is crazy.
I know, but I didn't think so at the time. You know, when you grow up with it, you're like, oh, everybody.
Wouldn't it run away?
No, I think so. If he ran away, my dad would probably, you know, hit the dog. Like, what the fuck, don't fuck around, come back here. Like, he would yell at the dog. So, no, Elvis stood there. And then my dad, now that I think back, he wouldn't even, like, blow dry the dog. He would just, like, tell Elvis off. And then Elvis would have to, like, shake it off and sit in the sun and hope that he got warm.
Oh, my God. This is the worst. I didn't even know that detail.
Yeah.
Dude, but he hosed
the dog down. And then
that's
also,
cold as ice, man.
I know, but in Eastern... But see, you have to understand, my dad grew up in Hungary.
Yeah, I know.
My dad
I always think about that.
My dad was like, the dog is... To warn you, the intruders is coming.
To take your bread and the milk that you only have for the rest of the week.
Right.
Yeah.
The dog is here, you know, as a warning system. It's not like a child. So he made the dog sleep outdoors in the cold. The dog was an outside dog for many years until my stepmother came in the picture and was like, you know, you got to let the dog sleep inside. It's an indoor. It's a small dog.
Yeah.
And you got to wash the dog with hot water. You can't. have the dog under a goddamn house. And then the dog would
He's like Borat.
Yeah. Oh my, my dad's totally Borat. And then Elvis would drink out of the swimming pool all the time. And I'd be like, do you really think that's healthy for the dog? He's like, oh, he loves it. Look at him drinking the water. He loves it. It's okay. Like, I don't know, man.
Everything is okay in your dad's world, though.
Everything.
That's the key ingredient to his philosophy is, like, it's okay.
He likes it.
Everything's fine.
It's fine.
And why are you getting worked up about shit?
Come on. Relax.
Everybody's having fun.
Remember when my dad came over when we first got Theo, like, the second day we had him. The dog was hacking. It was barely alive. My dad looks at him and goes, ah. I go, should we take it to the vet? He goes, nah, it's okay. It's a couple of days. He's going to be back to normal. A couple of days. I'm like, yeah, but he's not eating. He's listless.
Fine. He's fine.
Ah, it's okay. This dog got pneumonia. Could you imagine if this was my dad's dog?
Ugh.
Dead in 48 hours. Fucking dead.
Yeah. Unbelievable, man.
I can't remember my dad ever taking me to the doctor. I was trying to think, like, did he ever fucking... I think once we went to a... Kaiser when I was sick, and he just complained about waiting, like, oh fuck, so much, so waiting, what the fuck am I waiting for? Like,
okay. Unreal, man.
Yeah, man.
He really was like, don't worry about this dog, it's
don't
fine.
Worry.
Yeah,
but thank God you see, because the problem too is because I grew up with that extreme level of like, shake it off, walk it off, that I don't know when it's appropriate to go to the doctor.
Yeah,
like I will fucking be bleeding out of my head before I'll actually. You know, I like fractured my elbow and I was like, oh, I don't need to.
When does he go to the doctor?
You know what? You know when the last time my dad was in the hospital? I'll tell you. He works with forklifts and he had some weight smash his middle finger in the 90s. And he came home and it was completely black and blue, his finger. And it was a Friday, I remember. And I go, Dad, you should really go to the ER. He's like, oh, no, it's going to be fine. It's fine. It's fine. Sure enough, by Saturday, like I convinced him to go. And they were like, you shouldn't have waited that long. We're going to have to amputate your finger because he had waited.
Oh, shit.
Now, thankfully, he was like, fuck this shit. This is fucking bullshit. And he left. And he still has his finger to this day because he didn't let them amputate his finger. They took off the nail, but they saved his finger. And so some of that attitude's pretty good, I think. You have to be a little discerning. You can't believe everything these asshole doctors tell you. Because they fucking bullshit you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. That's pretty crazy, man. And that's directly in line with... I mean, nothing really surprises me about that, though.
With my pops?
No.
Hard Knocks pops?
Definitely Hard Knocks all the way, man.
Your family's the opposite, though. You guys are more like, oh, he needs to go to the doctor.
Oh, definitely. Well, it's different. Actually, it's different. My dad is zero... I mean, you have to be really fucked up where he thinks you have to go to the doctor. Yeah. He's not really a go to the doctor guy. I can remember like many times being like, this hurts. And he's like, yeah, you're fine. And like turn away from you. Like,
right.
And my mom would be like, it's consent. I think it's consent.
Right.
So that's, you have the, and then you have to try to find a balance in that. You're fine, absolutely fine, walk it off.
Yeah.
And you have cancer.
Right.
You have cancer because you scratched your hand. Right. Literally, cancer all the time.
Right, cancer.
This could be cancer.
It's cancer.
Could it be cancer? I'm like, no, I think it's a mole. Moles are cancer. All right, Mom.
I think, too, some of that is old world doctors not being very good in Hungary growing up.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you went to the dentist with a toothache, guess what? You're getting that shit pulled and no anesthesia. Like,
yeah,
you're going to feel that. So I don't think he trusts anybody with that shit. No.
Well, does he go when he gets sick to the doctor? Does he go like if he gets a cold or something?
No,
or
fuck no.
What about like a sinus infection or something?
No. The only time my dad will go to the doctor is if he's like peeing blood or like, no, I'm serious. Like he came back from our wedding, remember? And he was very sick. He had a flu and...
Really? So flu he goes?
Like I said, unless he's like... the symptoms were so overwhelming that he was like, I gotta go look at it. But he won't. No.
Fuck,
not
man.
Not for a flu. No way.
I get medicine all the time.
I know. It's good, though.
Well, the last time I got sick was right before the holidays. And I went through a round of antibiotics. It didn't work.
That's what happened to our little doggy.
Yeah.
That's devastating and scary.
Horrible. And I was really, remember, I canceled. First time I've canceled work in 10 years in stand-up. Never canceled before.
It's so crazy, dude.
Yeah, that was bad. Very bad.
I know, man. Yeah. It sucks. Don't get sick, man.
I know, man.
You know what I've been seeing a lot of?
What?
I don't know why. I've been driving on the freeways, and I've noticed, like, homeless people living by the freeway. Like setting up
underpasses and stuff.
No, dude, just out in the open, like on the two.
On the freeway?
Yeah, literally on like the shoulder. Yeah, dude, they had like a full tent set up, and I saw it. It was like a full homeless village. It was like two or three people in a tent.
You can't be on the freeway. That's crazy.
On the shoulder, I'm telling you, on like the shoulder in the wilderness there, all the green, and that was it. They were just living there. And I'm like, why? Because I've seen in the Middle East, like people walk on the freeway shoulders.
Yeah.
But these people set up houses, and I've seen it on the 405 and on the 2 in the last week. But like, what? But what's the utility? Like, do you think there's some utility? Like, cops can't get to you?
I got it. I know what it is.
What is it?
Less competition for your spot.
Oh.
How about that? Hey, man, that's, you know, a pretty sweet spot you got. No, I'm on the freeway now.
Right.
Do you want to come bank my shit? Not really. That's crazy, man.
Yeah, it kind of acts as a moat, right? Like the moat did to a castle full of crocodiles.
Those guys, by the way, I don't know how many people you've seen do this, but definitely some are going to die soon.
Hmm.
I mean, cars skid off onto the shoulder all the time. I mean, you see the medians all smashed up.
I just saw that on the 110. A car flipped. I was coming back from my sister's house.
For sure. I mean, haven't you been behind a car that its brake lights come on so you just swerve off?
Sure.
If the tent is there, what do you think is going to happen to the guys in the tent? You're like, yeah, that guy's face is all in my windshield now because...
But how do you sleep? I mean, the noise has to be overwhelming.
I kind of like... if it's not horns, I bet that's kind of... I like that.
Like white noise?
It's kind of peaceful to me. Yeah. Yeah, very peaceful. I like that.
I don't know.
That's nuts, man. Yeah, I mean, it's actually sad. Yeah, well, I mean, you go, God, how desperate are you? Where you're like, you know, I have no place to go. I'm going to set up on the freeway.
Right.
Where cars sometimes come by at 100 miles an hour.
Right.
It's nuts.
Again, it's got to be the natural barrier to getting fucked with by other homeless people.
I think so.
Because that is a problem in the homeless community.
Yeah.
Is that they beat on each other, especially female homeless. If you're a woman, you're homeless, it's very bad for you.
You get raped.
You get raped, you get beaten, and they beat up on each other. They take each other's shit. So maybe this is a good way.
So take my spot, man.
Right. If you're listening and you're homeless, go to the freeway.
And get a spot?
And get a spot on the 2, particularly, because there's not a lot of traffic on the 2.
The 2 is much slower. That's a good point.
Yeah.
I don't know if you really want to, encourage people to live on the 2, but there is a lot of room.
I'm not encouraging anybody to be homeless, but if you're gonna, and I never understood why the homeless went to San Francisco either, because it's fucking cold there. It's not warm like it is down here. If I were homeless, I would do like Hawaii. San Diego is a delightful climate.
Mm-hmm.
Los Angeles is too. I would do L.A.,
SoCal all the way.
SoCal. I'm not sure Arizona.
Yeah, I could do Arizona.
But at night, it's a desert, so it's super cold.
But it's not winter. It's not like Minneapolis cold. It's just, you know, it's a drastic turn. You know, you're talking about, you're not living out in the desert. You're in the city, right? You're in Phoenix. You're in Scottsdale or whatever, or Tucson. So, yeah, maybe like 40s or some 30s sometimes.
It's still so cold. I mean.
Yeah, but. Then you get the nice warm. I think that'd be all right. South Florida, I would do.
South Florida, absolutely. Have you ever spent the night out on the streets before?
No.
Really? Okay.
Spent the night on the streets?
Yeah. Like one time in high school, we stood in line for Susie and the Banshees tickets. And we did it all night at the... I can't believe my parents let me do this. I was like 15 years old and we camped out all night. And it's fucking cold, dude.
Did you bring blankets or anything?
Of course. We brought everything that we had, and you're still fucking cold.
Yeah.
It's not a pleasure, that's for sure.
Yeah. All right, well, here's a great piece of advice from your mom's house to our listeners.
Yeah.
Don't live outside.
But you look homeless, so I imagine a lot of people ask you, where is the best place to live, Tom, and what do you say?
On the two. On the 405 or on the two.
On the two.
There's ice cream with the candle sauce.
Yeah. I love that.
And there's no 15 rocks doesn't make a green bean casserole.
All right. All right, jeans. Oh, man.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Yeah, so guess what we're going to try to do again this week, jeans? So now we can tell people at least we're attempting to do this.
Okay.
We're trying to do 2 episodes a week. How do you feel about that as a listener? You guys aren't saying anything.
I didn't hear it, yeah.
No. How do you feel about it?
Pipe up, guys. Oh, I'm excited. I think we should. I feel like we're there. I feel like I want to.
I want to.
Because I feel like when we have guests, it's fun, but like it's not the core of your mom's house. You and I are the core.
Yeah.
Our dumb day-to-day shit is like, that's your mom's house. So
right.
I want to get back to keeping it real.
I like that.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
What do you think?
I've always been a fan of many and multiple shows. It was always a matter of, do we have the time to do it? Are we here to do it? Can we make them quality shows? So as long as we have the time and we can put the effort into making them good shows, I'm a huge fan of it. I would love to do, you know, maybe something along the lines of one episode with a guest and one without every week, something like that.
I like that.
You know?
Yeah, I like that because we keeps it real.
Yeah, we get 100. To do our show. We get to talk to our people the way we normally talk.
Okay.
And then we bring in a guest.
Okay, it's fun. I like that. You know what we didn't do? Theo's voice. Will you do it?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean that when the other day we were talking to Theo and you did a voice that sounded exactly like I think he sounds.
He's right here. We could just get him on the mic.
Oh, well, why don't we
have
him?
Why do you have me imitate him? He can talk.
Sorry. Hold on.
Theo,
come here, buddy. Hey, Theo. What's up, man?
Hey, what's happening?
Oh, did I wake you from your nap, Theo?
I was sleeping like a motherfucker down there.
I noticed you took some runny dumps.
Y'all keep giving me hot dogs. I eat that raw meat. It makes me guys the shits.
Well, we have to do that, Theo. I don't know if you've noticed, but we've been hiding pills.
I know that shit.
You know?
Yeah. I like the meats. I know you think you're tricking me. I don't know anything no more. I've been around a while. I used to smoke.
Sounds like you smoked. What'd you smoke?
I used to smoke Newports. 3 packs a day.
This is so amazing that you're finally talking.
Since I was 7.
Oh, my God. You smoked since you were 7?
7 years old.
I can't believe this. Theo, you've been with us since March 8th, and this is like really the first time you've talked.
Oh, shit. Yeah.
Where did you come from?
Downton. Yeah, I'm a Downton motherfucker. I live with Mexican people, man.
Mexican
people? Yeah, man. They used to have parties and piñatas and shit all the time, yeah. That's where I grew up. That's my home, but they wasn't like, y'all nice white folks. I like you guys.
Oh, thank you. What would you say is the best part?
Motherfucker pets me all the time, cuddle me and shit. Nice. Like that.
You like pets, Theo?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes you get aggressive with it, but I mean, I like affection.
You do.
I like affection.
And why did they give you up? Why did your family in Downey give you up?
Too many motherfuckers in one house. There's Mexicans. They already had like 8 Mexicans there, and then they had like 19 dogs, so they turned some of us in. And I got sick at that motherfucking concentration camp and died. That United my folks could pick me up, save a nigga life.
Yeah, because I mean, Theo, you know, when we met you at the shelter, they didn't really tell us, nor did you, that you were really that sick. I mean, I don't know. Were you shocked that you ended up in the hospital with pneumonia?
Yeah, shit, yeah. Especially after that nice vet lady with the hair bun. She gave me medicine, and I took the medicine. Y'all made me. I spit that shit out, but I ended up taking it. Yeah. I thought I was all right.
Did you have any girlfriends in the shelter? Do you miss anybody?
I still got girlfriends.
Oh, okay.
Look at these nuts.
I noticed
they didn't take my nuts yet, man.
I noticed you still have your testicles intact.
I'm quite deep in pussy on the regular.
I will say that Tom and I noticed that your testicles, mm-hmm. for such a small dog, are fairly large and dark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You sound like you're proud of that.
Yeah, look at this dick, too. This ain't no joke. This dick ain't a joke.
All right. Well, thank you, Theo. Maybe you could come back on the mic some other time.
You got it. Hey, y'all, thanks for taking care of me. Thanks for saving my life. Thanks for the donations and the orders and shit. I'm going to go eat a snack.
All right, Theo. Thank you. Thanks for talking to us, Theo.
Peace.
Wow.
I mean, that's amazing. Yeah, he's a beautiful
Theo
dog.
Theo the dog, you guys.
Beautiful dog, man.
Can you believe how smart he is?
He really is a special boy. Really,
there is a cunt on my anus.
So, big shout out, big thanks to The Voice, Mike Schiavello. Thank you all for listening to our show. We will be back Friday.
Okay.
With another new episode of Your Mom's House. There might be a guest.
Okay.
I'll leave it at that. Signing off. Don't forget to go to yourmomshousepodcast.com. Check out our store. Check out our dates. I hope you see us at all of our live shows. And don't forget April 16th. Please come if you can to Flappers. If you go to facebook.com/yourmomshousepodcast, you can like our Facebook page. You can comment on their posts there. We do too. It's a lot of fun. And you can follow us on Twitter at Christina P. And I am at
Poopface. P-O-O-P-F-A-C.
I'm at Tom Segura. Thanks for joining us, and we will be back soon. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye, Mommy.
Time for change. Killed the sun.